sovereign God to be the pattern for everybody that claims to be a child of God. My wife gets down in the middle of the floor sometimes and gets her cloth all fixed, and then she gets a pattern down at the store, and she pins here and fixes there and cuts there. After a while, she's cut out a piece of cloth according to the outlines of the pattern that she bought down at the store. And in the book of Timothy, every child of God is told that Paul has been divinely appointed by God to be the pattern. You to try to be like Paul. You to try to be like Paul. You're not to join the multiplied millions of Baptists today who are sitting on the step of take it easy, and they'll tell you they're all right. You remember that Christ Jesus had 12 disciples, and the only one of them that's dead sure he is saved is the one that betrayed the Lord. The other 11, when the Lord said to them that one of you is going to betray me, knowing the evil in their own hearts, they said, Lord, is it I? But old Judas, he is one of these no-soul folks, I know I'm saved. You watch those folks. They're sure for hell as I'm preaching to you. That's not what the Bible teaches. And old Judas, he didn't say that. Oh, no, sir, I'm all right. But he's the one that prays the Lord when I'm home. Now, the Bible says that a Christian is somebody that has laid hold on the hope that is set before him, and says that hope we have as an anchor for the soul, which is sure and steadfast. And it acts as a strong consolation to everybody who has fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope that is set before us, which hope is to have. You know, it's now entered within the veil, whither our forerunner, the Lord Jesus Christ, has for us entered. Now, if your hope is in Christ, that's fine. But if you want these, I know I'm saved. That's what that they mean. They made a profession of faith once, and they switched that back up from one jaw to the other and say, once saved, always saved. I'm going to heaven when I die. No, they ain't. They're going to hell. The Bible don't teach that. The Bible says anybody joined to Christ, married to him, united to him, a member of his body, a branch, and he's the vine. Amen? That person, he's saved. But this gang of church members that you couldn't drag to a prayer meeting, couldn't keep out of the frost, don't know what prayer is, don't know what witnessing is, it ain't talking about them. They haven't laid hold on Christ. They just made profession of faith and joined the church and going to hell. You believe that? That's so. That's so. And I want to read you about a testimony of a man who wrote the words about Christians, the people who laid hold upon a hope. You see what I mean? I ain't as cocky as this generation of hell-raising Baptists are. They can go see Grandma on the Lord's Day and claim to be a Christian. Okay. This generation of so-called church people can start their vacation and travel all day on Sunday so they can get to where they're going to have their vacation soon and claim to be Christian. This generation of church members can put their filthy hands on the first $10 out of the 100 that comes in their hands. God says, that's mine. God says, doesn't say the Christians ought to tithe. The Christian, the tithe, is a disgrace. That's all you do. You're just a disgrace. If you ever get saved, you'll start giving. The Bible talks about hilarious giving. But I know lots of people in 36 years going up and down this country swearing that Bibles, they're going to heaven when they die, and they don't even tithe. If they say they're saved. They ain't saved, they're thieves. If God let them get to heaven, they'd take up the streets of gold. put it in that safe deposit vault. That's right. You see, we got a generation of church members now that break every law that God ever wrote and claim to be saved. Huh? I'm not talking about that gang. I'm talking about people who fled for refuge. Brother, they got scared. They said, hell's a popping, I'm fixing to fall into it. Now, I don't want to have to deal with God's holy law at the judgment. It knows no mercy, no pity, and every sinner going to have to face God's eternal, holy, perfect, just, immutable law at the judgment. And there's not a bit of pity in God's law, and there's a bit of mercy in God's law. And the penalty's got to be exacted. You're looking at one person that don't want to come to the judgment and have to deal with the law of God. I don't want to have to deal with it. It kills everything it touches, and it'll damn your soul and send you to hell. If you stand at the judgment guilty of breaking the holy law of God, I need somebody to be my substitute. I desperately need a Savior. If I can't be joined to Him who is the Savior of sinners, I've got to face that law and deal with it myself. I don't want to do that. I don't want a little push. I don't want a little help. I want a substitute to take my place. I want to stand clothed in His righteousness and not in mine. I want Him for my Savior. But I want to read you about a man who was set to be the pattern for every Christian. And the ninth chapter of Romans, he gives us a testimony. And I am frank to tell you that since you and I live in a country where nearly everybody says he's a Christian, the good question is, are any of us? I'm preaching people, some of you I never saw before, and some I'll never see again, because you're in for a little something different. I'm not the usual preacher. And you're going to have to die if you hear me. Because no truth in the Bible can be accepted without you dying. You've got to die to take God's truth. This generation of church members never have even breathed their last breath in the claim to be saved. You can't understand the Word of God. You have to die to everything. Just take it by faith, because God says it. That's right, isn't it? And yes, the passage of Scripture makes me wonder whether I'm saved or not. I ain't as cocky as you are. But here's a man who was set as a pattern for Rolfe Barnard and for you. And in his testimony in the first verse of chapter 9, he uses language that I don't pretend to understand. He says, I say the truth in Christ. I lie not. My conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost. He says, when I say what I'm fixing to say, I'm not lying, I'm telling the truth. And he said, when I say it, that conscience, that thing that God gave every man, that rebukes you when you do wrong. And it's not yours to brag about, it's the gift of God. And says, when I say what I'm fixing to say, my conscience bears me witness. Said Paul, you're telling the truth. What you're so concerned about, Paul, well, the next verse says, that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. Now he's the fellow that's to be the pattern for every Christian. And yet I go from place to place. Now here I'm talking about God's people need to be revived. God's people need to have a burden for souls. And I say it ain't so. God's people have a burden for souls. This gang of church people all over this country, they don't give a hoot whether everybody goes to hell or not. But I'm talking about God's people with a pattern. The Apostle Paul, if you're a child of God, just buy your Bible, and you'd start paying a little attention to it, wouldn't you? And in it, you'd find out that the God didn't just put it in there to fill up a little space, that he means this. And if you dare, go around your claim to be a product of the grace of God and the child of a holy God. You take down your sign, honey, and go on to hell by yourself with trying to take everybody else with you. Show this ungodly world some of the marks of a Christian. And one of the marks will be a heavy heart and a sob that never leaves you, brother. I have great heaviness of heart. I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. What's the matter, you, Paul? My kinfolk's going to hell. For I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen according to the flesh. I don't pretend to know how to interpret that verse. I expect if I knew the awfulness of it, I'd go crazy. To be as Paul said, I could wish. Said if it gets the job done, you just send me to hell, Christ. If that'd get my kinfolks, my Jewish brethren after the flesh, if that'd stop them in their tracks, turn them into seekers after the Lord, he said, I'd gladly be sent to hell myself. God help us, he's the man that's the pattern for a Christian. That sobers me. I look at a scripture like this, I say, oh, my, I guess old Brother Barnard preached all his life and been sent to hell. A passion for souls. I'm so glad I'm 58 years old. I'd hate to be brought up in this generation where you can't get a corporal's guard to meet to pray together, where the nice rugs and beautiful floors of our church buildings have never felt a drop of a tear coming from the wet eyes of God's people as they take time out in this busy day, pour out their hearts in supplication to God for an outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Ladies and gentlemen, you are a disgrace to the name of Christ if you're willing to pretend to go through the motions of having a revival effort without the greatest agony and intercession you ever experienced in your life. As long as this generation of people think more of visiting than the later clock and make a beeline for the door as soon as the service is over to start cackling again, for nearly every Baptist congregation I've get preached to, the minute the benediction is pronounced, they prove to you they didn't pay a bit of attention to what it said, don't give two hoots in hell about God or nobody else. They'll start asking about the corn crop as soon as you say it. They've turned little church houses like this into places where they visit about the babies and you teeth and everything else. There's no tears. There's no heartache. There's no concern. Kenneth said the person who does not live to save others hasn't met Christ himself. And he's right there. if the thing that's the biggest thing in your life is not your job or your family or anything else, but to see those for whom Christ died brought to Him, you ought to quit going around here claiming to be a child of God. That's right. That's right. That's right. God help us, little nice, fat, self-satisfied, infidel Baptists that don't care about souls. That too tough for you? You're guilty of those, and you're disgraced to the name of Christ. To claim to be a Christian, that's somebody belonging to Christ, and He loves souls enough to come and be spat upon and crucified. And we don't love them enough to take a little time off to weep over them. Huh? I can backslide, that's not a Bible word, but I can backslide in the average prayer meeting quicker than anywhere else as well. Why, I'm talking to people here tonight, if God sentenced you to pray for 5 minutes, you'd go crazy. You couldn't pray 5 minutes to save your life. I'm talking to people here, you'd go nuts if you had to pray 5 minutes. Most of you couldn't pray a minute. Oh, you got a minute out, you'd be thinking about the latest fuss you had with your wife, or who's going to pay your bank note or something. You would. I'm pretty straight talking. But you see, I come here to represent a holy God and a Christ who died on the cross, and they both of them meant business in high time that we quit playing mumbo tag, take down our sign, or go to acting like we're a little like the Lord Jesus Christ. And somebody says, well, we can't be like Him. Well, we will be if we see when He gets through with us, but we could be like Paul. Because He's our human pattern, He is a human, I'm a human, and I'm not to be satisfied unless I've got a heavy heart, unless I've got a continual sorrow, amen? You see, my friends, we're living in a day now where they make a joke of hell, and it's high time people who claim to be Christians face the fact that hell ain't no joke. Wife and I went out to California just 4 or 5 summers ago to see our daughter. And we drove. And going into Las Vegas, Nevada, about 30 miles on any highway, going into that gambling, and divorce center, you know, Las Vegas, Nevada. Why, about 30 miles before you get into the city, on all the major highways, they told us, I asked about it. But on the highway we were going, we saw a signboard, 30 miles to hell. And we drove a little further, about 2, 3, 4 more miles, and we saw a sign, join your friends tonight in hell. And we kept on driving into the city. We're going through it at least on the way to California. And every few miles, we'd see another sign. Make who pee tonight in hell. And lo and behold, finally we found out that they had a nightclub in Las Vegas. And the name of the nightclub was Hell. And people were urged to make who pee tonight in hell. And join your friends tonight in hell. And the tragedy of it is some 80 some odd thousand people in the world will join their friends in hell while we're having this service. And they won't make much whoopee, but you see, they even name nightclubs now after that word that the pulpits are silent about. And about the only time we hear it is somebody using it to cuss with. And this generation found out that God's too good to send anybody to hell, and so we eat our big meals and live in our nice homes and come to our nice little churches and go through the motions and let people go to hell unwept over, unprayed for, unloved. God help us. I stand here tonight because God set His affection on me, and He set a college professor after me, and that college professor wouldn't let me go to hell. He loved me, and He wouldn't leave me alone. He wouldn't leave me alone. I've been in places where God's people got to mind in God, and men would get in their cars and leave the path. They had to, or surrender to God. I'd love to see it happen in Rhyme, anything that this nice little church does, where everybody's enjoying themselves and going to hell together. Because I tell you right now, this hell business, they have a nice club and say, join your friends in hell, but it's no joke. It's no joke. Men and women, you know what hell is? It is just exactly this. It is the place where the penalty of God's holy law is tested on men and women. Where men experience God's righteous indignation at men who live in His work and breathe His air and eat His food. You can't even grow beans. God has to send the sunshine and the rain. You can't even plant a tree. You can't even grow corn. You can't do a thing. Everything you've got, God gives you. This is His world. Isn't that right? And men live in God's world. Walk on God's earth. Breathe God's air. And spit in the face of God's Son. And when they come to the judgment, they'll be sent to hell to experience forever the awful penalty of the holy law of God. I don't want to face it. I don't want to have to live throughout eternity with the lash of God's holy indignation beating on my back throughout the reaches of eternity. That's what it is. It isn't any joke. It isn't any joke. You get mad at me. If you ever start getting your Bible and reading and facing some facts, you'll quit asking God to bless people now. What this generation needs for God to judge them, bring them to that. God can't save a man until He judges him and the sinner trembles there under the righteous weight of God's holy law and realizes something of his awful condition. If I had a loved one, instead of asking God to bless him, I'd say, Lord, burn his home up, cripple one or two of his children, send his wife to the hospital and take his job away from him, do something. Maybe he'd stop and think and not be so anxious to go on blowing the smoke of his unbelief in the nostrils of a holy God. That sound cruel? Which would you rather your boy do, have a little trouble in this life and go to heaven, or get along fine and go to hell? We believe the Bible, we'd be saying, oh God, shut them up to where there's no hope for them, nowhere else to go. For it's only then that men will lift up their eyes and look, for men will trust everybody for the will of God. You know that? They'll trust their home or the children or the church or the something. And men will never put their faith in God's Son until He takes everything away from them and leaves them in a position where the Holy Spirit can get a word in edgewise and plant the gospel seed. We need to start that kind of praying, that's right. That's right. I tell you what's the fact. This hell business isn't any joke. It isn't any joke. And I'm so glad I'm 58 years old. And somebody loved me. I'm so glad that I lived back yonder when they didn't pray, oh Lord, save the lost. And somebody said, oh Lord, save us. I never heard of the Lord saving people in mass. You know, I go up and down the land to call on some pious brother, and he says, if there's anybody in the service tonight that doesn't know Christ, please bless him. Now, he just will be out chewing tobacco and drinking whiskey, playing mumble peg. He'll give a hoop with him by saving us. If he did, he'd have got there on time and spied out some old sinner and sat beside him. Yeah, he would. And pray for him while the preacher preached. You wouldn't do that, no. But I'm talking about Christians. They on the ball. They're looking for souls. For Christians know that no lost sinner is ever saved apart from a saved sinner going after him and seeking him and bringing him to Christ. That's God's truth. Somebody wouldn't let me go, brother. That old college professor, he waylaid me. He ambushed me. He prayed for me. He wept over me. I don't know why God laid me on that old professor's heart. I just thank God he did. That professor couldn't save me, but he could set your weep over me. He couldn't save me, but he could set your ask God to save me. He couldn't set aside from me, but he asked God to break my old stubborn will. I thank God I'm as old as I am. I wish I didn't have this awful hurt. But I tell you right now, I hate it. I'd hate to be some of you young folks. I expect you boys will just go right on to hell. Your mother don't give a hoot whether you're saved or not. Your daddy don't give a hoot. They wouldn't mind you being religious, but they don't want to be. They ain't got time to pray, this generation of church members. They don't know what it is. The old-time mothers used to have a place to pray. I've been in homes where the boys had shown me the trail that mothers made. Where at a certain time of day she went and took her children to God. I've been in homes where the old man of the house had a certain time of day, and come hell, fire, damnation, he is at his place where he met God, took his children. We don't have that none today. Bless God, mothers and papas, deacons and preachers, no outfit with nice little people. And we don't know what it is to weep for souls. We don't know what it is to cry unto God with strong supplications. Amen. I'm talking to you tonight. You said you want to have a revival effort. I'm talking to every member of this church. Put a fire cell on top of that building. Say, the meeting's closed. Let the people around us go to hell. We haven't got time to weep over them. We haven't got time to pray for them. We haven't got time to put our arms around them. We don't care. At least be honest. Do one or the other. Anything except keep on going through the motions of having service is an insult in God by asking him to bless us when we don't know what it is to weep over so. Huh? It's still true that he that goeth forth and does what? Weepeth, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing the seed. Your truth won't get anywhere. Your argument won't get anywhere. But your tears, what God uses, not crocodile tears. But if you can't weep over lost people, for God's sake, quit claiming to be a Christian. My Lord wept over a whole city, didn't he? I believe if I was a Christian, I could weep over one sinner, don't you? I believe I could. I tell you what, you had to go up down the country like I do. I closed the grave. Landslide experience when the Holy Spirit just made a church over. It was amazing not long ago. And then I went the next Monday night to start a meeting, just cold as an icicle. Why, man, they didn't even know how to spell the word prayer, much less engage in it. You talking about weeping over souls? They thought I was crazy. And I have to go into ice boxes like that, calling themselves Christian people. And they say, we're going to have revival. Well, my God, there ain't nothing to revive. You got to have something around there that's got some fire, somebody that's got something to weep with, to shed precious tears and break sinners' hearts with the salt of the agony of their concern. Oh, I get so tired. If I could do it, this people down here in Pennsylvania, they want me to come up and start a school and be pastor of that church and pay me about twice as much money as I make now, and I could sort of take it easy the rest of my life. And I couldn't do it. That's not my calling. I'd rather be doing what I'm doing. I hate everything about it, but it's all I'm good for. And you've got something God called you to do, and that's all you're good for. And you're happy if you're doing it. You're not happy if you're not. But I sometimes get off tired in the pledge. We're there and say we're going to have revival. Haven't even wet the rug without tears. Don't know what weeping for sinners is. Don't know what intercessory prayer is. Grabbing hold of God and saying, blot me out, God, but don't send my boys to hell. I should wish myself a curse from Christ. Who for all? For my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh, they look the Son of God over and say, he won't do, and he cannot reign over us. We'll not have him for our king, and they're going to hell, and my heart's broken about it. Oh, for a passion for soul. For a passion for soul. For a passion for soul. You know, it is a terrible thing to take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. I don't mean get out on the street and use what we call cuss words. That means claim to be a Christian unless you are. Because a Christian don't wear his name. You've been given a new name, haven't you? He belongs to the Lord. And you represent him. You don't belong to yourself, don't you? Dude. And I tell you, it's a terrible thing for me to go down the street and say, I'm a Christian. I'm Christian. Unless I am. Don't take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. I was going through the state of Alabama where I was born. And I headed somewhere, I forget where, alone in my car. And I got lost. I thought I got lost off of my big road. And I was going along, and I said, I better stop and find out where I am. And I signed ahead, I was going to go through a town where I live, and I was about knee-high to a duck. And they done changed all the roads and everything, you know. 40 years later, and I thought I was lost. And I saw an old farmer with a one mule plow, Georgia stock. I don't know, you know what that is. But he's plowing along, and I stopped my car and waited till he got up to the fence row. And I was there waiting for him, and I made myself acquainted with him, and told my name was Rolfe Barnard. And he told me his, and he scratched his head and said, Barnard. Oh, he said, would you know a fellow named Jim Barnard? I said, well, Jim Barnard was my daddy. He's a school teacher in Alabama with many. Oh, yes, that's one I told him. And he had a big old chore back in his mouth, and he twisted over to the other side and gave a big spit and squinted his eyes. And he said, well, Bub, I never seen you before, but if you Jim Barnes, boy, you're bound to be all right. See, he wasn't bragging on me, bragging on my daddy. God help you, bud. Going around here claiming to be a Christian, unless when people see you, they brag on your heavenly Father. Say, boy, you bound to be all right because you're a child of God. Amen. That humbled me. That humbled me. My daddy's the best man I've ever met yet. Greatest Christian personality I've ever seen. Guess I'm a little prejudiced because he's my daddy, but he walked with the Lord. And that old farmer knew it, and he just figured that if Bill Barnard was my daddy, I found to be all right. Oh, God, help us if Almighty God's our heavenly Father through faith in his only begotten Son. We're a member of his family. We're bound to be all right. We mustn't take the name of the Lord out God in vain. And the thing that's drying about churches and they're fixing to go out of business, honey, don't you kid yourself. God ain't going to put up with this stuff we've been calling Christianity forever. We headed for judgment like we never dreamed of. And the only way it'll be a verdict, if there are any Christians in our churches, when we go to acting a little bit like Christ. There's one thing that's certain. About the Lord Jesus Christ. He didn't leave heaven, come down there and be spit upon, crucified, just for a little exercise. He came down here because God so loved the world. Right? He didn't come down here to condemn the world, but he came down here to the world through him might be saved. God help us to be a little like the Lord. I was up in Boston, Massachusetts. First time I'd held a meeting in New England, being from the South, they found it a little difficult to understand me. I found it very difficult to understand them. They're very nice people in Boston and New England, very cultured, very dignified, very quiet and reserved. And I remember that I started the meeting on Sunday morning. My wife was with me, and we preached Sunday morning and Sunday night, Monday night, Tuesday night, and Wednesday night. And after the service Wednesday night, I said to the dear pastor, I said, "Brother Pastor, I believe we ought to close the meeting tomorrow night, is what I believe." And, oh, he said, "Oh, no, no, we couldn't do that." Well, I said, "I was just making it as a suggestion. My judgment is that we ought to just close out, and I'll go back home." Well, he said, "What on earth's the matter, Brother Barnes?" I said, "Well, we're not getting anywhere." I said, "I don't seem to be able to get over to you and your people." And I said, "So far, you've not done one thing that I've asked you to do." Well, he said, "Brother Barnard, you are a little strange to us." And I said, "I'm going this way, and you folks going that way. We dead sure not going to have the blessing of God that way. Somebody wrong around here. And since you was here before I got here, and I'm the visitor, it's your invitation, and my messages and what I ask you to do, you don't do a thing about it." I think I ought to just say, "Well, I'll close my part of the meeting. You folks won't go on with it." And he was greatly disturbed. "Boy," he said, "just ruin everything if you did it." He said, "What on earth's the matter with you, Brother Martin?" I said, "Well, you just won't do a thing I ask. And I either ought not to ask you to do some things, or I ought, and if I ought to ask you to do some things, and it's right that I do, then you ought to do it. And if I'm asking you to do things that are against the scripture, you ought to run me off." Well, he said, what are you talking about?" I said, "You want me to pray?" I said, "I haven't seen the church on its face, sweeping your part to God. I've been asking you to do it, and God's not going to bless people if they're not that kind of people. I just tell you that. You might have some more folks join the church, but God ain't going to save people in an atmosphere of dry eyes and prayerlessness. You know that, so, isn't it?" And I said, "I've been asking you to go out here and talk to people and witness to them, bring them in your cars, invite them out to the services." He said, "Well, you know, Brother Martin, we've never done anything like that in our lives." I said, "I'm beginning to believe it." And I said, "Well, my wife and I are going on to the room, and it's all right, I'll preach tomorrow night and we'll close the meeting." We went on to the little apartment they had for us, and after a while, somebody knocked on the door, and the pastor, bless his heart, had gone and got the deacons. And they filed in, and they were greatly disturbed. They said, "Brother Barnes just came to fool to close the meeting. Said it just hurt everything. People were on the wire." Well, I said, "I don't know what else to do." And they said, "Brother Barnes, if you stay," they wasn't thinking about me, it was the reputation of that church. And so they said, "If you will not close the meeting, we'll do anything you ask us to do." I said, "Too late for that. I don't want to ask you to do anything just because I ask you. I want you to do it because it's in the Bible and because God wants it." And they said, "Well, tell us one more time what it is." Well, I said, "I don't know. I wouldn't want you to do it. Just save the reputation of the church. Got too serious with that. But if it's so, if I've been asking to do what God's people ought to do and what they insult God if they don't do, and they in these awful days say they're going to have a revival effort because all hell's against you, and we just sit around, well, we just well quit before we start, haven't we?" I can name you 1,000 obstacles tonight. You could name me another 1,000, couldn't you? Well, if it's a prayerless, tearless, witnessless, began to call himself Christian, they know you start talking about having a breath from heaven. We ain't going to have it. We can use some tricks and get some children to make a profession of faith and go on to hell. But you can't raise dead people from the grave in that kind of an atmosphere, can you? You can't do it. And I think that a church insults God if it says we're going to have an effort to have revival and don't have it. Either you got an awful little God, there's something wrong with it. Huh? It's a shame and a disgrace to say we're going to try to have revival and not have it. Because that's a slam on God. He's supposed to be a God that hears prayer, isn't he? And he's supposed to be a God that works miracles. He used to. Huh? Well, bless God, we better swap the God we got off. Get acquainted with the God who answers prayer and does things. Huh? I think a church is under obligation to get its prayers answered. Don't you? Don't you? Huh? It sure does. It's a slam on God as it can. And so we turn to the book of Acts and we read about how daily in the temple there ceased not to teach and preach the Lord Jesus Christ in every house. And they said, we never had done anything like this, but it's in there, isn't it? I said, yeah. And they went out. And Thursday night, the house was packed and jammed. They'd been having little corporal guards, you know. And those fool folks, when they did something, they did it all over. They went home, got on the telephone, and must call every member of the church. The next day, every spare minute those folks had. They invaded all the saloons and dives and everything else in that section of Boston. And I don't know whether they killed anybody to get them down there or bribed them, but they brought everybody to the door. Nobody in Boston had ever been invited to Jesus. They're just very dignified. Folks go to church once in a while, not kill anybody, you know, about like it is in Ryan. And they just went out there and they began to do what the Bible says. Amen. And I preached that night. When I got through preaching, a little old girl, before I got through preaching, began to sob. And we stood up before we could sing any kind of an invitation song. And she came running down to the front, just fell on all fours there in that left plush carpeted church building, dignified. That's why I went down and dealt with her a little bit. And that's why she stood up and said, Jesus is in jail. Found out she's a little 16-year-old Italian girl, and that's the first gospel sermon she'd ever heard. Somebody, some of the girls went and brought her. She didn't know A from zero, but you see, a sovereign God, he can do things as he pleases. Sometimes it takes him 40 years to save a man, sometimes save him the first time he hears the gospel. You know? And I think the little girl got saved, of course, I won't know if they'll get to the judgment, none of us will. But they'd like to scare everybody to death. They never seen anything like that. On Easter, they always took the children into the church, you know, and that's all they knew about. And so I had them do like I do down south. I had them come around and shake hands with them by coaching them a little bit. They used to making a beeline for the door, but they all came down. Pretty soon, the ice began to melt a little bit. And so the service dismissed after a while. Friday night, that was Thursday night. Friday night, the little girl won the service. And Saturday night, she wasn't at the service. And I got a little worried. And I went to the pastor and I said, Brother, something about it. I got trouble in here about that little girl. I said, you know where she lives? She said, no, preacher, I'm sorry. I said, we were so excited. About what happened, we just saw anything like that. Nobody asked her where she lived. We don't even know her name. And I felt awful bad about it. But he said, tell you right now, said, if she's not here in the morning, we're going to organize and we're going to comb this city and find that little girl. Said, I'm troubled about it. But Sunday morning came and she was sitting in the congregation. And so happened. My wife was sitting in the pew just in front of her. And that morning I preached on hell, the sinner's long home. Now, as I've been preaching about 25 minutes, they said, that little Roman Catholic Italian girl, the Thursday night of it, stood and said, Jesus is in here. She began to cry, and quit crying and began to sob. And pretty soon her body just rocking with sobs. And my wife slipped her arm, put her arm on her shoulder, and pretty soon the wife rose and the little girl rose and they broke up my sermon. They came down that richly appointed church building. And my wife brought her up on the platform with me, rolled up her sleeves, had her turn around, rolled her dress down as far as it modestly allowed. But with a look at her face, her back was just terrible welts, and they were festered and fevered. The arms were cut, and the face was cut. And she stood up at the while, and I saw a church born. She told what had happened to her to that nice Sunday morning crowd of Baptists in Boston. She said, Thursday night, I ran home, I was so happy, and said, Mama and Papa, and my brother and my two sisters were in the front room. Said, I went in and told them that Jesus Christ had come in there and he was mine and I was his. She did, might not have used good theology, but she told what happened. And the daddy said, where are you there? He said, I went down to the Baptist church. They had a meeting down there. And said, I never was anything like it, Daddy. He said, all I know is that Jesus is in here. And her daddy got up. And Italians I've seen in New York many times. He went and got an old black snake whip I used to use on the mules on the farm. He commanded his girl to stand, and she did. And he whipped her with that black snake until she lost consciousness. And she said, I don't know how long I lay there, but I was awakened by pain. And said, I opened my eyes just in time for my two sisters standing on either side of me, kicking me in the ribs. When they got through, my brother came and spat in my face. My mother came and cursed me. And my father told me to get up, so I don't know how I did, but I did. He looked me in the face and said, if I ever hear you talk like that again in this home, I'll kill you. Go to your room. He said, I went to my room and he turned the key in it. I didn't have any medical attention Thursday night. Friday morning, my daddy came, unlocked the door, and handed me a piece of bread and a glass of water. I stayed in the room all day Friday. And Friday night, in the meantime, those welts were feverish and festering, and I was in mortal agony. Saturday morning, he came, and I was waiting for him. I was desperate. As he turned the key in the lock, and as he put his hand on the door, as he turned it, I let him turn it just enough I knew it was open. Then I jerked it right quickly, and he fell in the room, and I darted out. Said I had so much fever, I guess I had superhuman strength. And I ran out of the building. Said I wandered around the city and found an old empty freight car. And I stayed in it all day. When the sun went down, I went to a pharmacist, a drugstore. And the pharmacist knew me. And he treated my wounds, son. And I slept that night in the empty freight car. Said Sunday morning, I was hungry, and I was sick, and I was hurting. And I said, what shall I do? And then she said, I remember the Jesus people. And I said, I'll go up where the Jesus people are, and they'll help me. And she come and came and took her seat. And she was in pain, sorry for herself. She's afraid to go back home. And she said, I feel so sorry for myself. And then I began to listen to the preacher. And he talked about that awful place. That the while said what I wish would happen to me and to you. I forgot myself. And all I could think of was the daddy that whipped me. The mother that cursed me. The sister kicked me. The brother that spat in my face. They go into that awful place the preacher's talking about. And then so help me. A little old Italian girl lifted her hands up like this and began to weep. And she broke the heart of that crowd. I saw them just like a mass fall on their knees. And I was in a prayer meeting. She said, "Oh Jesus, people, won't you help me keep my people from being sent to hell?" Oh, I said, "I'm going to tell about that poor little old Italian Roman Catholic girl. She didn't know as much about scripture as you folks have forgotten. But she knew two things. First, Jesus, then Jair. And her loved one was going to be sent to hell. She didn't want him to go. And she thought she could say, "Oh, Jesus, people, you'll help me, won't you?" It looks to me like that if we do belong to Jesus, she could say, "You'll help me. You pray for me, for my loved one, won't you? You will." Oh, yes. Closed the meeting on Sunday night, and I asked again in New York City Monday. The pastor said, "Let me get on the telephone and call them in New York City and say, 'You won't be there till Tuesday.' Said, 'You just got to stay over Monday night. We're going to have baptizing, and I want you to have the pleasure, a great pleasure.' And I said, 'All right, I will.' We made arrangements, and they had a boat that came Monday night. Everybody's going to be baptized, and the church is there. And the deacon got up and made a motion that the church authorized the evangelist to bury in baptism. A man and his wife, three daughters and a boy. And I went down in that pool, and five people came there, and I got them all down in the pool together. I baptized that little 16-year-old girl. And then I baptized her mama. Then I baptized her daddy. Then I baptized her two sisters. And then I baptized her brother. You believe people going to go to hell. You'd weep over them. You'd pray for them. God help you. Yes, we would, folks. One more time, little buildings like this would be known as places where the Jesus people meet to worship God. Lift up their voices in unison, asking God, who alone is the answer, come to the rescue. I long for that. And it could happen just like that if we want it. Amen. Oh, for a passion for soul. I'm so glad somebody loved my soul. And I think that if you are saved, you can put your faith on somebody that loved you, couldn't you? Huh? And I think that there ought to be somebody you love and just will not let go to hell. Huh? That's God's way. Let us think.